Here in the Vault, we are ultimately about sports, and sports is ultimately about winning. And few franchises define that like the New Jersey Devils. Hi, everybody. I'm Al Troutwig. Welcome back to the Vault. And today, we analyze the rise of the Devils. It wasn't always easy for this team, like the night in 1983. And we've got the tape of Wayne Gretzky and the Oilers crushing the Devils that leads number 99 to call the Devils a Mickey Mouse operation. It became a rallying cry for the franchise until they broke through and made the playoffs for the very first time in 1988. And if you think about it, they're part of the Stanley Cup conversation for almost two decades. With all the player turnover, there's one constant, Lou Lamoriello. In fact, I'm probably not even standing in this building were it not for him and John McMullen. Along the way, we'll talk to Ken Danico, Glenn Chico Resch, and Rich Scher of the Newark Star-Ledger. All of them know about the Devils from day one. But we begin with the man who made the Devils possible in the beginning.
Without the dedication of Governor Kane, Jan Hansen, Bob Mulcahy, and all the other members of the Sports Association, that it just would not have been possible. They were really the catalyst to creating a situation where the National Hockey League had to consider a team here in the Meadowlands.
I am very concerned about the reputation of New Jersey in a general way. I think it has to be improved. And one of the ways that I'm trying to improve is with a good hockey team. And what I'm trying to do is, as far as hockey is concerned, is to realize that it's a great benefit of the state, at least I think so, many people probably don't. And we're trying to get the best possible arena, and which means the best possible source of revenue.
Joining us now on the Vault is Glenn Chico Resch, and wow, with John McMullen. Love this place, or what?
It was his dream to have a place like this. I know it was to be in Hoboken, that was his primary dream, but to see this, it would have been great for him.
Now, Chico, you were traded after winning a Stanley Cup with the New York Islanders to the Colorado Rockies with Steve Tambellini, and you would have a game at Madison Square Garden in which you were in goal and he scores a goal, and that's pretty cool, isn't it?
It was, you know, it was a painful day. I remember we're going to Winnipeg on the bus, and it's 2 o'clock, and I'm thinking, why isn't Al Arbor on the bus? Why aren't we going to the airport? And I saw Lorne Henning, the assistant coach, coming down the aisle of the bus, Al, and I'm thinking, this isn't good. He's looking for someone. I wanted to hide under the under the seat so he wouldn't see me. But he looked at me and went, and I said, I'm gone. He went. So we went in, and that was very emotional. Al Arbor was great. We were crying, and Steve and I were traded. But to go to Colorado was going to be fun because the next game was in Madison Square Garden. And I didn't know any of the players. Lanny McDonald was on the team, Rob Ramage, a few names. But we went in there that night, and in dramatic fashion, Steve Tambellini scored a goal to win. And I thought, well, this isn't going to be too bad.
All this is about to unfold. 1983-84, it's the New Jersey Devils and the Edmonton Oilers, and guess who's analyzing the game? Doc Emmerich and John Davidson. Enjoy.
Just underway, a minute and 20 seconds gone in this opening period, and a minute 35 still flashing on the minor penalty assessed to Wayne Gretzky. As always, capacity crowd here at the Northlands Coliseum tonight as Dave Cameron weaves in and gives back to Mulvey for a fake shot. This passes over to Gagne, has Russell in back and hands to him, and Russell shoots, deflected off. Your rebound, they score! Dave Cameron with a power play goal, and it is 1-0 in favor of the Devils. Oiler fans very quiet right now, watching their team stagger a bit in the early going. 3 minutes gone, and the Devils are leading 1-0. This is Jan Ludvig. Let's it go, score! Jan Ludvig with a drive from 50 feet, and it's 2-0 Devils.
You have to question the Oilers' scouting reports on the Devils. I'm sure that anytime Jan Ludvig gets the puck, he loves to shoot it. And here you can see why. He's got a great shot. What a beautiful shot just inside the goalpost.
Now, wait a minute. Chico, 2-0. You guys are in great shape.
Looking good, Al, but just hang on. Wait a few minutes, and you'll see how it changes.
It is Wayne Gretzky.
And the Devils lead in this game 2-0, in case you're just joining us, on goals by Dave Cameron, his fourth, at 1:43, and Jan Ludvig, his seventh, at 3:07. Pat Conacher, one-time Ranger. Jackson, one-time North Star, taken down. So this is Conacher moving right back in. Dropped it off for really no one in particular, it seemed. And this one is collared by Jackson, who just curls it back across to Pat Conacher. Has Hughes moving and banks one off for him, but instead it will go Bob Lorimer's way. And Lorimer for the Devils plays it off the skate of Mike Antonovich, who can recover back out. Avoids the hook check of Hughes and then throws it into Conacher, who just swats it back ahead for Pat Hughes, has Hunter on the wing, and Pat Hughes will backhand it himself, but that blocked away by Lorimer. Then Hunter puts it behind. Hughes centers, and Gretzky chops that one back to Kevin Lowe. Lowe turning to control as a couple of Oilers sweep to the front of the net. Lowe just looking and still in front. Score! Wayne Gretzky.
Certainly doesn't take the Oilers very long to get back into hockey games. They seem to have the ability to score goals when they're needed. Lowe took his time and took his time and took his time. Nobody checked him. Now watch Gretzky get into position. He's got a stick on the ice. Bang, bang. Ronnie Lowe had no chance. We've got a couple of out-of-town scores here. The Islanders, after being thrashed last night, are up 3-0 in the second period against Washington.
Oh, they score! And collecting that one is Willie Lindstrom. Bad stop by Ron Lowe first, and then Lindstrom ties the game at 8:52. As back ahead, it's Anderson along now to Yari Curry with a 1:10 power play. Gretzky cranks one, and that one a big save to Ron Lowe. Ludwig has it and just looks for an opening to clear down.
Devils doing a fairly good job killing it off. When you get Gretzky behind the net holding onto the puck, anything can happen.
Here is Yari Curry flipping cross ice. Greg with it there. Coffey and Curry to his left as it's sent right off and then over to Curry. And sliding across to make that play was Ron Lowe as Curry didn't get as much Steve on it as he wanted. Now Gretzky across. Curry scores!
One time he didn't quite get the shot off properly, so they decided to do it again, and this time he did his job properly. Ron Lowe, disappointed. Watch the play here. Jesse's going to move the puck right across. Curry's going to snap it right in through the side of the net. He's a right-handed shot over on the other side of the ice, which creates a better scoring angle for him. A terrific pass by Gretzky. It was an instant replay in the play they had just tried where Lowe made the big save. The second time he couldn't. Power play goal for the Edmonton Oilers.
18th of the season for Yari Curry, and we'll pick up the assist, but here's another try. Score! Willie Lindstrom! And the juggernaut gets cranked up.
Away they go.
So it's 4-2 Edmonton at the end of one, but the plot will thicken. We'll have more with Glenn Chikoresh here in the vault.
When I came in 87, they had never made the playoffs, but they were a hard-working team. And John McMullen made a commitment to me that he would do what was necessary and allow me to do what was necessary to win.
Back here in the vault with Glenn Chikoresh. You know, Chico, to me, one of the great things about listening to this broadcast is Doc Emmerich and John Davidson. Just think about that pairing for a moment and how it happened. But early in their careers and what they sounded like.
Well, as you know now, they're both Hall of Fame announcers. But back then, I thought, who's this teenager doing the play-by-play? His squeaky little voice, right. And he had great insight. Of course, that was Mike Emmerich, but he still had the sayings, Al. And the one I stuck out to me was when Davey Lewis, I think it was, tried to hit Wayne Gretzky and missed him. He said, trying to hit Gretzky is like trying to nail Jell-O to a tree. And he still had those great sayings, and they were a great duo and brought great insight to this game.
Chico, tell me what you learned and what happened to the Islanders growing up, winning the Stanley Cup, and what you hope for the Devils.
Well, you know, it took the Islanders 7 years to win the Stanley Cup, very short period of time. And I saw some of the same foundation being built here with New Jersey, Al. But the franchise needed, you know, a big-time coach, someone who could bring it all together, and they needed a superstar player. And, of course, it didn't happen right away, but eventually it did.
Well, this is the Devils on the rise, making the right moves, getting to the place that they wanted to be, slow process. And the same thing was going on with Wayne Gretzky and the Edmonton Oilers.
And so in the forechecking traffic, it's back to Larmer and then again to Kitchen. As Hunter just wanted to ram into Larmer on that one, but instead it's up to Broughton. Has Larmer ahead, nudges it along to Larmer and then to Ludwig and then to Larmer, who lets one go. He scores! Jeff Larmer cranking one through the five hole, and it's 4-3 Edmonton.
Some pretty passing by the New Jersey Devils all the way up the ice. Quick, sharp passing here. Ludwig makes a good play back to Larmer. Look at the room he had. He moved right in, right through the legs of Grant Fuhr. He was out, but he got handcuffed.
So with 7.5 minutes left in the second period, Oilers ahead in the game 4-3. Broughton just yanks it back to Larmer and then off the stick of Hoffmeyer. Really doing a good job of slowing this game down and containing, though. Here comes Gretzky. Pass across, and it's shoveled wide by Strube. In front, he gets a second chance. Curry goes sliding. Little pass to Gretzky in front. Score!
Unbelievable how puck always ends up on Gretzky's stick. It's going to be Devils lying all over the ice here by the time it goes in the net. And watch Strube getting checked quite well in front of the net. Curry gets it, moves it across. Now watch Gretzky and Lowe battle for the puck. Everybody's lying all over the place. Gretzky finds it, and as usual, puts it right where it belongs for him in the net.
This one picked up by Broughton, but as he headed to the slot, he lost it, and so it's Barry right back for Edmonton. That one off Russell, and a chance for Jackson. Moves right in to Lindstrom, who scores! Check that. It is Lindstrom scoring, but the pass came from whom else but Gretzky.
Wayne Gretzky could have taken the shot himself. He turned around to watch him look. See, he's looking already. Who am I going to pass the puck to? He's already looking. He's looking again right on the stick of Lindstrom. Lindstrom, a left-handed shot. Gretzky put that pass right on the stick. Watch it again. Just a perfect pass. Lindstrom just skated right into the puck, took the shot. Ronnie Lowe had no chance.
Dave Lewis has it knocked ahead by Gretzky to Curry. They've got a two-on-one with Pozar the opposite side. Curry in front, and it caromed off Lowe and in. Jari Curry with his second of the night. Lindstrom has a hat trick and Gretzky with two, and that totals to seven. The advantage the Oilers have now is 4-7-3.
Here you see it. It's going to deflect right off Joe Cirelli's, right off his skate. Ronnie Lowe anticipated the pass. It went through his legs. Not much a goaltender can do on a play like this. Cirelli tries to stop the pass. It goes off his skate blade into the legs. Jari Kurri's second of the night, his 19th goal of the year.
It is a hook on Lewis as you get a chance to see the Devils at their bench, and standing is Hector Marini. And behind is Marshall Johnston, who has taken this role before while Billy McMillan has watched up top, not only this season but last year. Power play on, it's Gretzky behind, Anderson in front, and Gretzky just seems to go where he pleases. Cross-ice pass broken up by Hoffmeyer and on to Cameron in the final 15 seconds of the period. Oilers will have to hustle if they want to get anything in on low in these final dozen seconds. But hustle they can, and the man leading it is Paul Coffey. Here's Coffey going right by the defense. He scores! What a play, coast to coast by Paul Coffey. You can't start much deeper and go much further more successfully than Paul Coffey just has. His ninth goal of the year, and it comes with just 4 seconds left in the period.
Now it's 8-3, Chico. You're not in there yet. The one thing about Glenn Sather and the Oilers, they didn't exactly lift off the gas pedal, did they?
Glenn Sather loved to run up the score, and this was no exception for sure, Alan. I got to tell you, after the second period, when we went in the dressing room, I'm keeping my head down. I don't want to see the coach saying, Chico, you're in. You've taken over from Ronnie. But unfortunately for me and Ronnie, that's what happened.
Oh, that tap on the shoulder is going to come. See what happens when that happens right here on the ball. More with Glenn Chico Resch, a Devil from day one, with them commentating when they win the Stanley Cup. When they do that, because of playing in games like the one we're watching, does part of you win the cup too?
Absolutely, Al. That was all of our dreams. Those first fans, the Mr. McMullen, of course, was around when that first cup was won, and myself included. That was our goal, and it took a while, but we finally got there.
But you have to take your lumps to win something like the Stanley Cup, and that is exactly what happened in this game against the Edmonton Oilers.
It's a hooking call on Strebe at the 1 minute 30 second mark of this third period. Third Devil power play, and it is Kitchen to be the trigger man along with Russell once they get it set up. Off Mulvey, but this is Hughes driving one. That one clutched by Chico Resch, and he puts it right into play, handing it on to Kitchen, and Chico receives quite an ovation from the fans here as that one goes off to Russell. Russell turning in some traffic, but gets it now out to Gagne with McLean at the line, running a screen, and Gagne scores! What a ripper! Wrist shot by Gagne, and a power play goal. It's 8-4. 9:40 to go in the third. From Antonovich to Hoffmeyer, rolled it through, but Greg got it, but now this is Larmer, and Jeff Larmer to Antonovich for a backhander that went off Pozar. And Mahar couldn't slug it through, so this is Pozar right back to Curry, and then on to Gretzky, moving on Bob Larmer. Gretzky just drops to Curry, then to Gretzky. Back for Curry, score!
Did you see that? Gretzky had himself a wide open net, passed it back to Curry. I don't know if the guy gets bored of scoring goals or what, but just look at this. Watch the passing again. Everybody in New Jersey backing up. Back pass. Another forehand pass to Gretzky. He's got an open net there. Instead gives it back over to Curry, and he taps it in. My goodness.
Gretzky with two goals and now four assists. And just to reiterate what had been said earlier, with one more point, which he just got, why he is an even three-point performer on the season in this, the 21st game. Nice finesse move by Gretzky to play fair. This time drive, save, break, rebound, score by Curry. And Jari Curry has a Texas hat trick to four goals.
I might go out of retirement if they need a left winger. I used to play minor hockey, left wing. Man alive, I go stand in there and get goals. Look at this. Watch Gretzky get it. There he is. Is Curry in the net? Devil's guilty of backing up here. See how they back up, enable the shot to be taken. Chico makes a big save. There's not much they can do about it. Boy, oh boy. Fourth goal tonight for Curry, his 21st of the year.
Zarella wraps one around to Jan Ludvig, and Ludvig's bump off the puck by Strebe, and here it is to Anderson. Resch shot is blocked by Resch. Rebound by Strebe is knocked down. And so it's gotten by Aaron Brunton in the final 5 minutes and 50 seconds of this third period and likely the game. Zarella bumped firmly by Lumley, and this one is gotten by Strebe, who is just locked up by Ludvig. So Joe Zarella comes by to help out, wrapping it off for Aaron Brunton. And he's stepped into by Lumley, and Playfair scores! First NHL goal for Jim Playfair. Most goals in the entire NHL last year, and of course they're well ahead of anyone close to them this year. They came into this game as there's a shot on Fuhrer and then a rebound by Gagne. Cameron playing in the corner trying to sidestep Coffey. It's passed behind but away from Gagne after him, and bumping with him is Pozar. And so everyone getting in internationally to the act tonight as Coffey moves on Phil Russell. Cross ice pass, Curry scores!
Boy, what a shot this is. Chico a little bit deep in the net. Now watch Curry shoot the puck right on the ice. Off the goal post. Boy, when things are going right, they're going right for Jari Curry. What a great pass across the ice, right on the stick. Maybe a little bit of a deflection off the defenseman. Five goals in one night. That sets the record for the Oilers. They're 12 goals in one night also. Randy Gregg pulls his hand on the puck and threw it back up towards the blue line to get himself out of trouble. And Davey Newelson, 2 minutes, delay a game, I'm sure that's what they'll call it.
So we stop play on the whistle. What are you thinking? It's a penalty on them.
Well, I know Glenn Sather, he wasn't much of a scorer when he played, Al, but he had a team that could run the score up. I go to our bench and I say, guys, we're down by 8 goals. We have a power play. But we're not going to score 8 and tie this up. Let's just not let them get that lucky 13. Within a couple of minutes, they get the 13th goal, a terrible breakdown, and that was just the stake in the heart that really capsulized that game.
Let's watch the finish.
And you know that Gretzky's trying to set Curry up for a 6th. Curry's tire just went off the ice again, but you can see Gretzky stop there, wait to pass the puck, and try and set him up.
Here is Anderson, free to Gretzky.
Curry should have stayed out a little bit longer. What a play. Watch the moves. What a pass across by Anderson. Now watch the moves. Chico's got no chance. You're all alone. Him against the world. Here's another look of it. Watch Gretzky's body movement. Watch the glorious hand movements, the quickness. Watch it going all over the place here. A fake in the open net. And that's the hat trick for Gretzky.
So now the best player in the sport of hockey, Wayne Gretzky, goes on the record and says the New Jersey Devils are a Mickey Mouse operation. Wow, did that reverberate. The next game here, everybody's got the Mickey Mouse hats on, and it did what for the organization?
Well, for the players, it was the greatest game that we had for 3 or 4 years. The place was electric, Al. We really wanted to show the fans that we could gain revenge on what Wayne had said. It was a terrific game. Unfortunately, we didn't win it, but it was a great atmosphere. And from that moment on, I think Wayne struggled against the Devils. And in fact, when his career was over, he said the one mistake he made publicly was making that statement. And I think it affected him.
Thanks, Chico.
Thank you, Al.
Rich Scher of the Newark Star-Ledger will join us as we continue talking about the rise of the New Jersey Devils here in the Bowl. About 2 months after number 99's Mickey Mouse comments, Devils fans gave a warm welcome to Chico Resch at the 1984 NHL All-Star Game played at the Meadowlands. But was the New Jersey crowd as kind to the great one?
And from Edmonton in his fifth All-Star Game, number 99, Mr. Gretzky. He had some choice comments earlier this year about the New Jersey Devils, and he gets a reaction of cheers and boos.
We're following through with the game plan that Dr. McMullen set out 4 years ago. I think that right now we have a chance of really realizing that. Max McNabb sometimes was criticized because he would not give up some of these draft picks. What they should do is commend him for staying strong when the Devils weren't winning, knowing that there was a bright future.
So here in the vault, we're watching the New Jersey Devils come of age. This is Lou Lamoriello, year one. How about Lou Lamoriello, day one, with Rich Scher, who's been with the Devils and covering them since the very beginning. Rich, what do you remember about Lou Lamoriello doing immediately?
Well, he was the same then as he is now. He did not waste time making the moves. You know, I remember he came in as president of the team in the summer of 87, and he was only the president of the team. Immediately made himself the general manager, made his first big trade that year in training camp. He acquired Patrick Sundstrom, the center, and he traded a pretty good young player in Greg Adams and a goaltender named Kirk McLean, and really, he was in control of the team from that point on.
This game that we're going to watch, how significant is it in Devils history?
I know they've won three Stanley Cups, but to me, it was a turning point for the franchise, and to this day, the overtime goal is still the most exciting goal they've scored, including Jason Arnott's Stanley Cup goal, I think.
You know, every team has their moment where the franchise goes one way or the other. Kirk Muller's in this game, obviously, against the Chicago Blackhawks, but he represents one of those moments, doesn't he?
Yeah, he was very controversial that they did not get in 84 in the draft. They could have had Mario Lemieux. They wound up with him. He turned out to really be a key figure in this team's history.
Now, Rich Scher will stay with us as we go back to 1988. It's the last game of the season for the New Jersey Devils. Win, and they're in the playoffs for the very first time.
Kirk Muller out to take the draw. Letzig out against him. See if Letzig will move in for the faceoff. As we continue, no score. We've had one shot by each club thus far in this second period. 9-7, the advantage to Chicago. Blackhawks now shorthanded on the penalty call, and the Devils will have their fifth power play chance in this game. They have not been able to convert on them. See what they can do with this one. They'll go through the middle to Broughton. Broughton got turned around. Puck was knocked away. Bob Murray. Murray had a poke check to center. Verbeek trying to back it up. Murray takes it away again. Murray had that one knocked away to Broughton. Good play by Broughton. Murray's got it again. Murray will clear this one up, and it goes off. Broughton in on Burke. Wants to push it in behind the net. Backhand chance. Graham, and the save made by Burke. Dirk Graham, good play, and he was on his way to the bench on that one.
And Gary, again, the Devils just do not look organized out on the power play. They're a little bit hesitant right now, and as this game continues 0-0, more and more pressure is put on Sean Burke.
Because there is no pressure on the Blackhawks. Savard. Sorella shut him down, but he got it right back into the middle. Pushed up a little more. Defenseman there, Sorella. Joe Sorella will clear it in. Bounced right in front of the net. Right in front. Shot wide by Sundstrom. Devils keep it alive. Johnson centered right underneath Thompson's stick. Sundstrom comes back and gets it. Sundstrom in. Shot. Saved by Pang. Big piece of goaltending on another one of those hops off these live boards. And it is cleared up and off the glass. Burke will play it. Pang had gone all the way behind the net. The puck ricocheted right out in front. He got back in net, made a big save. Sutter centering Presley. Presley kicking at it. Turns back. Takes the shot. Wide of the net. In front, tip by Sutter. Kept alive. Sorella trying to tie the man up. Does Mark Johnson off the boards. Sundstrom. Sundstrom flipped it up. It was knocked away by Manson. And Chicago keeps it in the zone as Presley goes out in front. No penalty call. Sorella did not get called. They said it was a dive out in front. As Larmer took the big dive, and the fans wanted it, did not get it. Danico will have to chase this one down. 9-10 to go in the second. Danico.
Here the Devils are going to have to be careful. This is one of those cases we talked about. with two or three close calls are going to build up, and he's going to call one soon on the Devils.
Kurt Muller brought it in there. A paper cups on the ice that I don't think people see at the other end. Danico winding up, takes it, score! Kenny Danico, and the Devils lead 1-0.
Ken Danico, who has not scored too often, is only his fifth goal of the season, could not have found a better time to get it, to pull one out of the bag here for himself, and gets the Devils a 1-0 lead. The Blackhawks are very upset with the officiating, but a nice play by Kirk Muller carrying the puck. What great stick handling right there. Finds Danico, and they beat him with a fart. His shot, I'm not sure if it's screened here, but puck will find itself just to the left side. Did Loisel tip that? I'm not sure.
I don't think so.
No, it looked like it went straight in.
Looked like it went straight in, and it looked like Pang had a pretty good look at it. Pittsburgh about ready to do what they needed to do tonight. Empty net goal, Mario Lemieux. Pittsburgh 4, Hartford 2.
And Gary, if he hadn't scored one earlier, that was definitely his 70th goal of the season.
Cleared out for the Blackhawks.
And only Gretzky and Phil Esposito scored that many goals in a year.
Great year for him. Now he just waits to see the other final. Savard ahead. Vibe with him. Savard through the screen. Scores! Dennis Savard using Vibe's screen in front. Ties this game at one.
Gary just saw what Dennis Savard does so well. You never know when he hits that blue line what he is going to do. If you give him the blue line like the Devils are forced to do on this play because he's coming so fast, he can do absolutely anything in there. He's an amazing player. Now he'll dart behind Vibe, and Caesar's a screen right off the goal post in the bottom corner.
And goes to the wide side post. Dennis Savard gets his 44th goal, his 131st point.
More with Rich Scher of the New York Star-Ledger. What are the key fingerprints that Lou had on this team?
Well, you know, everybody will always remember John McClain for scoring the winning goal in that overtime period. But the two key people that he brought in, really, for that run in 88, he changed coaches. It was his first coaching change. He would make others.
Mm-hmm.
But it was his first coaching change in January. He changed from Doug Carpenter to Jim Schoenfeld. Became a huge figure. A lot of young players on this team would look to Schoenfeld. They needed his approval of everything. He was really the leader of this team. And the other big acquisition, and the players on this team will tell you that they waited for Sean Burke to come out of the Olympics and to join this team. Until he got there, this team was going nowhere, and he was really the key that down the stretch.
What do you think of Ken Danico adding a goal in this game?
Well, Ken Danico was so emotional in this game, I think the other players fed off that, and Schoenfeld sensed that, and it probably his toughest job in that game was keeping Danico as calm as he could possibly keep him. Danico wanted to try to win that game himself, and Schoene had to keep on him, actually had to sit him for a little while.
That's still our job all these years later with Ken Danico. Rich, thanks for sharing your memories.
Thanks, Al. I appreciate it.
That's Rich Scher of the New York Star-Ledger. When we come back, the man who's number 3 hangs in the roof here at The Rock, Ken Danico, the rise of the Devils.
Dano just was a constant source of comedy, but not that the teams we played against ever considered him funny, because he was a ferocious and very protective teammate, and he has really earned the right to be called Mr. Devil, because he has always been completely loyal.
And scoring a goal in a game like this, one the New Jersey Devils had to have, Ken Danico, and it's one of the reasons why his number 3 is up in the rafters here at The Rock. Do you remember scoring the goal clearly or not?
Absolutely, I remember it very well, for the simple reason that after I scored the goal, it was the first one of the season, Kurt Muller drops the puck to me. Good slap shot, goes by Darren Pang, and I go back to the bench. I've only been out there about 20 seconds, and Jim Schoenfeld is our coach at the time, and he goes, "Stay out there, Dano, stay out there." I said, "Get me off the ice, I'm way too excited." I had to regain my composure. So it was a great thrill, though, and got us off on the right foot.
You know, we have the newspapers from the season before, when you went on the record and said, "I guarantee we're going to make the playoffs next year." So it was a little Joe Namath, a little Mark Messier moment. Why did you believe that this team would make it?
I did say that?
Yes, no. Yes, you did.
I had a passion once in a while to say the abnormal, but you know what? I just believed in this organization. I saw the youth. We were growing together. We didn't have some very good years, obviously lean years when the franchise came in 82, but I saw the pieces coming together. Muller, Verbeek, McLean, then Shanahan came along as a high draft pick. Joe Sorella, Sean Burke came on the scene. So I just felt we had to have that bravado. We had to believe in ourselves. And, you know, if you don't raise the bar, it may never happen. And fortunately, it happened.
This is a man, remember, who said the following when he found out he had been drafted by the New Jersey Devils. What did you say?
I said, where is New Jersey? I was in the kitchen with my mother, and we were so excited. And the phone rings and said, congratulations, Ken. You've been drafted 18th overall. Obviously, I didn't listen to the team, and it didn't matter to me because I would have ran wherever I had to run to get my opportunity. But my mother goes, well, ask who it is. I go, oh, yeah, by the way, who is this? And it was Marshall Johnson on the other end said, this is the New Jersey Devils. And I turned to my mother and said, where is New Jersey? I had no idea, but it didn't matter. They were going to give me my opportunity.
And now he calls it home. And the rest is history, just as this game was.
The New York Rangers have now taken a 3-0 lead in the third period over the Quebec Nordiques. The Devils must win in order to have that fourth playoff spot if the Rangers are going to win their game. Pittsburgh has already won theirs. Pittsburgh has a shot at getting in if... Well, they don't have a shot at getting in.
The Rangers win their game. They move past Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh has no chance with the Rangers winning.
Back up to Thomas. Pittsburgh could only get in if both the Devils and Rangers were to lose. Shot there. Score! Tipped in front. Murray took the shot into a screen. Tipped in front of Schonberg, and it's 2-1 Chicago.
And this is back against the floor. Good shot from the point by 14-year veteran Bob Murray. But Dirk Graham just will redirect this back against the floor. It's going to Burke's right, and he deflects it back to his left.
Short-handed unit out there, Troy Murray for Chicago. Kurt Muller will take the faceoff for the Devils. We'll try and get this tied up in 44 seconds of the second period. Muller kicking at it. Won it, then lost it. Kept in by Broughton. Nice play by Aaron Broughton. Back down to Muller. Muller tied up. Verbeek tipped it the other way. Heath Brown trying to pin it, couldn't. Muller gets it, goes to the point, tried to Driver, didn't get it off the boards hard enough, and Graham brings it out.
Gary, that pass hit Fraser, the referee, and Muller was very upset.
Yeah, hit Fraser and prevented it from going back to the point. When you get to this point, everything matters. Muller in. Dropped it back, Driver, the good keep. Driver, Willannon, shot, save, rebound, score! Patty Verbeek, power play goal at 19:52, and this game is tied at 2.
And Gary, that penalty that they killed when the score was 2-1 just after the Devils missed a chance, it will be an important part of the game, because all of a sudden now, instead of 3-1 Chicago, the Devils are back tied 2-2. Verbeek, with his 46th goal of the season, just does what he does. He's done so many times. Standing right there, he gets slashed and takes a punishment right in front of the net. But he always seems to find a way to score that goal.
That'll be his 13th power play goal of the year for number 16, Patty Verbeek. And as Peter said, his 46th overall. And at 19:52, the Devils get this thing tied up at 2-2. What a finish we are going to have here in Chicago to this game. Randy Valachek, intended for Konecker, got by him. That will roll in. And that's going to be it. So the Devils pull a big, big power play goal out of their hats in the final minute of the second period to even it up.
Still here with Ken Danico. He keeps saying, I guaranteed this. I guaranteed this. We'll find out how the Devils deliver as we continue here in the vault. Meanwhile, in his first year, here's Lou Lamoriello's plan.
We had to make some improvements in certain areas. I thought we had to get bigger. I thought we had to get stronger. And I thought maybe that we should just have maybe a little more intensity. I'd like to think that we've added that ingredient. And hopefully that will be the little extra to carry us where we'd like to be.
I don't know that anybody really affects your team like a goalie can in that one moment. So Sean came in and got on a roll for us and really became the backbone of our team.
Still watching this game with Ken Danico. Now, Sean Burke joined the team right after the Olympics and was a big reason why you were able to pull this off, right?
Well, he really was. I mean, the pressure for a young goaltender to come right in the National Hockey League lineup, and the Devils trying to make the playoffs for the first time in history. So Sean Burke came in with the utmost confidence, and he was absolutely terrific.
Getting to the playoffs in the most dramatic way possible in the last game on the last day of the season. Back for Gary Thorne and Peter McNabb.
Sean Burke, the young goaltender in net, trying to come away with yet another victory. 9-1-0, 3-0-6 goals against and an 8.84 percentage save. The young man has made an enormous difference, if not just because of what he does while he's in net, of what he has done for the players in front and the way they play in front of him.
It just seems, Gary, like some quarterbacks, the blockers seem to just block better when he's in there. The defensemen seem to play better defense when he's in goal.
All right, let's see how it ends up. Johnny keeps it in at the point. Third period underway here in Chicago. Over 16,000 on hand for this one. Kurt Muller on the feed out in front, intercepted. Muller coming in a 3-on-3. Muller drops it off, and we have an offside call. Rangers trying to look and pray and hope that Chicago can do something here. Devils fans just the other way around, because one of those two teams will be in the playoffs, depending on how this one ends. Rebound came in front, Sutter over to get it. We're down to 11:06 in this 2-2 game. They'll wave off any icing. It'll have to be a major penalty at this point before it'll be called, a very obvious one. Flip back the other way. Both teams trying to change here. Pang will have to leave it. Picked up by Bergevin. And Chicago back. Too far ahead on the pass. Willannon's got it. It was intended for Sutter. Back up intended for Johnson. He didn't get it. He'll wave everything off again. Pang clears it around the boards. Rolls to the line. Shot by Willannon. Deflected out deep. Here he comes. This is the one. Savard scores!
Troy Murray just makes a great shot. He blocks the shot at the point and just breaks down the ice.
So you're down 3-2. What is it like playing in a game, because you played in so many pressure games? What is it like playing in a game when you know it can end in just a few minutes?
Well, I think we were such a young team that we didn't let the pressure get to us, but we knew the importance. Let's not kid ourselves. It was pretty quiet on the bench, but we knew. Let's lay it all on the line here, guys, because we've had such a terrific stretch to get ourselves in this position. And it was nerve-wracking, no doubt, when they went ahead, but we still believed.
Has any coach or any teammate ever said anything in that circumstance that was part of the solution? You know what I'm saying? Did anybody ever say something that really mattered?
Well, I have to say Jim Schoenfeld came in as a young coach and really gave us that emotional boost. He was a real fiery guy, and he was, I don't remember one specific thing, Al, but I think it was more along the lines of, believe in us. Come on, guys. He went up and down the bench, patting backs, I remember, and just keeping us going, keeping us believing that we can tie this thing up and we're going to win, even if it takes 60 minutes plus, which it did, but he was really an emotional leader at the time.
In the history of the Devils, this was one of the most important days.
Faceoff will be at center, and it will be taken by Troy Murray against Mark Johnson, and Murray wins yet another draw.
He's been outstanding job in the draw tonight, but this is the Devils' hot offensive line. Sundstrom, Johnson, and McLean had 9 shots second period, Gary, and it really sparked the Devils getting back into the game, so that they need to have another big period, another last good 10 minutes.
Troy Murray got tied up, taken by Manson, who cleared it around the boards and did get it out. Harry Anderson is back. Patrick Sundstrom with the puck. Presley was on the forecheck. Moved up. Sundstrom. Sundstrom, Manson drives into the boards. Mark Johnson in. Johnson the shot. Save. Pang. Rebound. They scored! Johnny McLean puts it in, and he's tied the game up at 3-3 as Darren Pang could not hang on to the rebound.
And Mark Johnson, Sundstrom took a hard, hard hit at center ice by Manson, but he got the puck up to Johnson. Johnson will spin right at the blue line. He could have just dumped the puck in, but he spun and took his time. Now watch the first part. Watch Sundstrom take a check to move the puck. Hard check by Manson. And now Johnson, watch him cut across, shoot through the legs. But right there is where the play is made. McLean out-muscled his man. He wanted that puck right there more than the Chicago player.
And the Devils have come back to tie this game up. Can it get any better than this? His 22nd goal of the season for John McLean.
6th in the last 7 games. Could not have picked a better time to get hot.
11:57, the time of it in the third.
So the Devils get one goal they absolutely had to have, but John McLean was about to cement his place in New Jersey Devils history. We're headed to overtime after this.
It was a brand new group, new general manager, new coach, a lot of new players. There were all the core players were young. So the connection to the Mickey Mouse days, we really didn't feel anything about that. We were very confident with, you know, our new identity and who we were.
That's not the score, not just yet, but we just heard from Brendan Shanahan. What did you learn about him in this first year?
Well, I love him. Here's a second overall pick. He's playing on the fourth line, and he's supposed to be this prolific scorer coming out of junior. And he's fighting guys like Willie Plett. He's doing anything it takes to be part of this and part of the success. And I think it was a big building block for his career. All he did is go on and score 600 later, but he laid the groundwork that he was going to be a physical presence and do whatever it took. He wasn't pouting about, you know, being on the fourth line. And I couldn't believe at 18 years old he looked like a baby taking on big guys like Willie Plett.
What did you think of, if you can remember, back heading onto the ice in overtime?
You know, we know it's all on the line. I mean, there's not much can be said. We knew the importance. This meant so much to us, Al. I mean, you know, we've been through some dismal years, but we wanted to show the New Jersey Devils are here. We're going to make the playoffs, and we're going to make some noise now. And we believed in ourselves. However, we know it's a coin toss, but we were going to lay it all on the line.
It's a celebration that he and that team remember to this day. That's for certain. Let's go back to the game.
Again, we remind you, if this game stays tied towards the end of the overtime, Jim Schoenfeld will have to pull Sean Burke at some point, because they have got to win. Troy Murray and Kirk Muller on the faceoff, and Murray wins another one and trips Muller after he won it. Back to get it is Brown. Brown sends it off the glass. It went into the bench.
Again, this line, Gary, Johnson, Sundstrom, and McLean are really giving the Devils an outstanding evening.
The Devils bench.
You know why they're bending over like that, Gary? Their stomach hurts so much.
That's right.
you have to find some way to relieve it. It seems to be the only way is to just bend over and rock.
Mark Johnson is waiting to take the face off. Stick over linesman conferring with Fraser. Larmer will take it for Chicago. Even up, 5-on-5 now. Bob Murray cleared it around the boards. Stepping up, Mark Johnson trying to keep it in. He and Lahmer are tied up. Patrick Sundstrom moving in. 3:09 left to go. This would be icing. It's not going to roll far enough. It'll have to be waved off. Danico will be back to get it. The tie will do nothing for the Devils. They've got to play to win. McLean off the board. Sundstrom. He's alone. Sundstrom. Murray on him. Shot. That was deflected. Went off the skate of Bob Murray, the defenseman. Flipped up by Chicago. Not out. Kept in by McLean. Good job. McLean centered Sundstrom. Sundstrom back to the point. Joe Cirella. Cirella got in. Cirella takes a shot. Saved by Pang. Rebound. They did it. They did it. The Devils make the playoffs for the first time in their history. John McLean, the overtime goal. And they win it 4-3. First time in the franchise history, the New Jersey Devils have made the playoffs. Jim Schoenfeld, Kenny Danico, John McLean got the game-winning goal. Two goals for him in this game. He tied it, and he won it with his 23rd of the year. And the Chicago Blackhawks, who did everything they could, couldn't quite do it.
Gary, the Chicago Blackhawks played a magnificent game, but boy, I'll tell you, the Devils deserve it. They came out the last two periods. They had the jitters the first period. They had a real slow start. But the last two periods, they came back. And Gary, you just can't be any prouder of this group. You have to feel terrible for the New York Rangers. They just did everything they could possibly do. But the Devils, look at that. Is such a great picture.
Anytime I want Ken Danico to smile, all I have to do is say 1988. See, it works all the time. Here's what the Devils remember about that celebration.
I can still vividly remember, you know, him scoring, turning, racing all the way up the boards, and we kind of caught him as he got near our blue line. So he basically had to skate, you know, I don't know, 140 feet or so until somebody caught up to him, and I raced across the ice.
You would have thought we won the Stanley Cup the way we all reacted, but it was the first time the Devils had ever made the playoffs, so.
It was the Stanley Cup for the Devils at that given time. I mean, you know, here's a team that had never made the playoffs. The game is tied. You have to win in overtime. You can't gain a tie. So the emotion and the excitement that had built up to the climax of the shot going in, I can still see it. and I still get the chills.
Okay, Dano, so what do you remember of the celebration?
I mean, all I remember is everybody going in a different direction. We didn't know how to celebrate. A bunch of young kids never made the playoffs in Devils franchise history. And make no mistake, this is the biggest moment in this franchise's history. No doubt about it. I just remember everybody going in their own different direction. I remember me flying all over. I remember Joe Cirella going the other way. He cut in, gets the nice shot. Johnny Mack bangs home the rebound, we know. And then I remember giving Shoney a big hug. You know, it was just a special, special moment.
What did you see on TV the next morning on the news when you woke up?
Well, yeah, and not to rub it in, but you reflect on history and stuff, and we remember a lot of the New York Rangers. They had just beaten Quebec earlier in the day, watching the game around some television. I don't know exactly where they were. I think it was a hotel room. You know, praying that we lose in overtime, and when we scored, we saw how dejected they were. And when you look back at the time, we're like, yes, yes. But when you look back, somebody has to win, somebody has to lose. And it was a very emotional time, obviously, for us. The jubilation for the Rangers at that moment, certainly a lot of sorrow.
And as for Wayne Gretzky, by 1988, let's face it, Mickey Mouse was a billionaire, so it was all good to be a New Jersey Devil. Thanks, Dano.
You're welcome.
Thanks to Rich Scher, thanks to Glenn Chico Resch. The rise of the Devils is now cemented. Three Stanley Cups prove all of that. I'm Al Trautwig in the vault. We'll see you again soon.
The New Jersey Devils have a magnificent miracle finish to the season, going 7-0-1 to beat out the New York Rangers, and they will play the New York Islanders in the first round of the Patrick Division Stanley Cup playoffs.